हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माई सेल्फ अरबाब खान, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर NHOD, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी, DK कॉलेज डुमरांव। फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द कंट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ ग्रेट ज्योग्राफर अलेक्जेंडर वॉन हम्बोल्ट। दिस डिस्कशन इज़ पार्ट ऑफ योर BA पार्ट 3 ऑनर्स सिलेबस, पेपर 5th, सेक्शन ए, ज्योग्राफिकल थाट। सो इन दिस पार्टिकुलर चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द लाइफ एंड वर्क्स ऑफ अलेक्जेंडर वॉन हम्बोल्ट एंड हाउ डिड ही इन्फ्लुएंस द ज्योग्राफिकल एक्यूमेन, ज्योग्राफिकल नॉलेज एंड व्हाट वॉज हिज कंट्रीब्यूशन टूवर्ड्स मॉडर्न ज्योग्राफी, टूवर्ड्स मॉडर्न साइंस एंड what was his work. So all those things we are going to discuss in this particular lecture. So let us start. Friends, Alexander von Humboldt was the universally acclaimed as the father of modern geography. We can call him as the father of modern geography, and he was one of the foremost intellectuals of his time. He was a versatile scholar who contributed appreciably to the fields of geology, botany, zoology, physics, chemistry, anatomy, etc. Humboldt was born in 1769 into the Prussian family or Germany. His father was an officer in the army, and in 1787-88 Alexander entered the University of Frankfurt, but after only 6 months stay he returned home. In 1789 he went to study at the University of Göttingen. It was here that he met George Foster, under whose influence he developed a lasting interest in the field of observation and the study of plants. So Humboldt accompanied George Foster on a trip down the Rhine River to the Netherlands, and from there by ship they went to England. There he published a short monograph and several articles on the Rhineland basalt. In 1790, in the company of George Foster, Humboldt made his first foreign tour through Holland, Belgium, central and southern England, and northern France. In his monumental work Cosmos, Humboldt has acknowledged that his interest in geography started with the acquaintance with the George Foster. In 1791, Humboldt joined the School of Mines at Freiburg in Saxony, where he studied under the renowned geologist A.G. Warner. Here also, alongside geology and mineralogy, Humboldt continued to pursue botany. So in his earlier life, Alexander was more inclined towards botany. He carried out scientific experiments on underground plant life in mines, and in 1793 he published his first scientific paper entitled Florae Freiburgiensis. Afterwards, Humboldt traveled to region of South America, starting from Cumana in Venezuela. He explored Lake Valencia and noticed that size of the lake had shrunk and cropped fields had been developed on its feet banks. He attributed the shrinkages of the lake to the deforestation of neighboring areas. In 1799, he explored Orinoco and established the truth of its connection with the Amazon. In 1802, he climbed the Chimborazo mountain in Ecuador. In course of climbing the mountain peak, Humboldt made observation regarding the effect of altitude on human physiology. After reaching Lima, Humboldt traveled along the Peruvian coast and there investigated the chemical properties of guano. Guano, you know, it is a bird dropping, and sent samples to Europe for further examination. And he was also trying to use this guano as an alternative to fertilizer. on a sea voyage from Colio in Peru to Guayaquil in Ecuador, he measured the temperature of the ocean water and for the first time described the movement of ocean water, including the unveiling of cold water from below. He was the first who named this as a Peruvian current. So what we study in physical geography as Peruvian current, this particular name was given by Humboldt. In 1803, he sailed from Guayaquil to the part of Acapulco in Mexico. Here he collected data on the geography and economics, including the latest population statistics of the colonies. This letter formed the basis for Humboldt's regional account of Mexico. In 1840, he returned home via Havana and Philadelphia. Again, in 1829, Humboldt was invited by the Tsar of Russia to visit the city of Petersburg and was entrusted to explore the virgin lands of Siberia, and traveling through much of Siberia on horseback, he reached the borders of Mongolia. So, Alexander was a geographer in its true sense, because unlike Carl Ritter, he was not an armchair geographer. He used to travel to the places, he used to visit to the places. So, just imagine, he crossed all of the Siberia on horseback. It was quite difficult in those times because of the harsh winter condition prevailing there. So, throughout his Russian expedition, he kept on taking observations of temperature and air pressure at different places, and ultimately deduced that temperatures varied at the same latitude in accordance with distance from the ocean. On the basis of the temperature data he collected from different weather stations set up by Tsar, Humboldt constructed the first map of average temperature, in which he used lines to connect points of equal temperature called isotherms on the basis of isothermal maps. So Humboldt developed the concept of continentality, that continental climates are warmer in summer and colder in winter than places near the ocean at the same latitude. So Humboldt is credited to have coined the term permafrost to describe the permanently frozen soil of Siberia. The most well-known work of Humboldt, Cosmos, was published in 1845. It put together in one unified work all the various interests and discoveries of Humboldt's lifetime. The first volume of the Cosmos provided a great general representation of the whole picture of the universe. The second volume begins with a discussion of the portrayal of nature through the ages by landscape painters and poets, and then continues with a history of main effort to discover and describe the earth since the time of ancient Egyptians. The third volume was developed through astronomy and the laws of celestial space. The fourth dealt with the earth, and fifth and final volume was projected to contain a general discussion of plants and animal geography as well as study of man. So Humboldt's contribution of geography is enormous. In an early work, he briefly touched upon the limits of various sciences and distinguished between physiographia, nature geography, or natural histories, where the emphasis was on the development of things in time, and geognosy, or Weil-Bischofberg, which discussed the spatial distribution. The science of spatial distribution thus established was not limited to the Earth's surface. It was rather a description not of the Earth but the whole world, that is the science of cosmos. Aeronography, which had the task of describing the celestial part of cosmos, may be translated as descriptive astronomy. Humboldt also differentiated between physical history and physical geography of the world along the lines almost similar to that of Kant. The first part of Humboldt's work reflects that he shared with Ritter the concept of unity of nature and agreed that the task of physical geography was to demonstrate this unity. Humboldt emphasized that in order to stabilize this unity, the relationships of organic life to the inorganic surface of the earth must be investigated. The investigation of this relationship was the task of geography. And Humboldt believed in the inductive method and emphasized the importance of empirical method of research. He also made comparative study of different geographical regions, especially that of steppe and the desert. He also believed that all human races had a common origin and no race is superior or inferior to others. Thus, it is to Humboldt that modern geographers are indebted for many of the geographical methods that make their work practicable. Humboldt's monumental work, Cosmos, was published in 1845 and was well received all over the world. It was translated in a number of foreign languages. Cosmos, a comprehensive account of the travels and expeditions of Humboldt, was written with the following fourfold objective. First is the definition and limitation of the physical description of the world as a spatial and separate branch of knowledge. The second is the objective content, which is the actual and empirical aspect of nature's entirety in the scientific form of portrait of nature. Third, the action of nature on the imaginative faculty and emotion become an incentive to nature studies through the means of travel, description, poetry, landscape, painting, and display of contrasting groups of exotic plants. And fourth, the history of natural philosophy and the gradual concept pertaining to cosmos as an organic unit are dealt with. In brief, Humboldt's objective in writing Cosmos was to develop a universal science. So, in the world of great geographer Sri Majid Hussain, Humboldt believed that all the races of man had a common origin. So, all the races have evolved from a common ancestor. So, this particular thought has provided a way of unity among the human beings. And no race is superior to superior or inferior to others. So it was Humboldt who deeply opposed the idea of racial discrimination. In his work, he said that no race, whether African or European or Asian, are different to one or another. Moreover, he stressed the need of casual observation of nature in the field and careful measurement of observation. It was an approach towards the theory building and model making. In brief, Humboldt sought answers to a great variety of specific questions. So, Humboldt was the last master of universal science. So, friend, this is all about Humboldt. हमारे हिंदी माध्यम के बच्चों के लिए मैं हिंदी में कुछ डिस्कशन करना चाहूँगा हम्बोल्ट के ऊपर. तो अलेक्जेंडर वॉन हम्बोल्ट, इनका जन्म 1769 ईस्वी में हुआ था और इनकी मृत्यु 1864 ईस्वी में हुई थी. इन्होंने लगभग 90,000 किलोमीटर की यात्रा की और इन यात्राओं में इन्होंने महत्वपूर्ण अवलोकन किए. इनकी जो फेमस रचनाएँ हैं वो है मध्य एशिया और एशिया सेंट्रेले, कॉस्मोस अर्थात विश्व, ये पांच खंड में है, व्यूज ऑन नेचर या प्रकृति दिग्दर्शन. दोस्तों, अलेक्जेंडर हम्बोल्ट उन भूगोलवेत्ताओं में से थे जिन्होंने प्रथम बार काल मापी का प्रयोग करके भूमि पर देशांतरों को निश्चित किया एवं वायुदाब मापी की सहायता से ऊंचाइयां निश्चित की. उन्होंने ओरिनिको तथा अमेजन नदी के प्रवाह क्षेत्रों की खोज की. उन्होंने वनों एवं वर्षा के बीच में घनात्मक संबंध बताया और हम्बोल्ट ने मनुष्य एवं वनस्पति पर ऊंचाई एवं तापमान के प्रभाव के वैज्ञानिक दृष्टि से वर्णन किया. उन्होंने पेड़ों की ठंडी जलधारा की खोज की एवं इस जलधारा के तापमान एवं गति को मापा. उन्होंने ही सर्वप्रथम पनामा नहर बनाने का विचार दिया था. साइबेरिया की यात्रा के दौरान किए गए प्रेक्षणों के आधार पर उन्होंने यह निष्कर्ष निकाला कि तट से अधिक अंदर जाने पर समान अक्षांशों पर तापमान भिन्न हो जाते हैं. साथ ही उन्होंने सर्वप्रथम समताप रेखाओं को प्रदर्शित करने वाले विश्व मानचित्र का भी निर्माण किया. साइबेरिया की तुषार भूमि की व्याख्या के लिए परमाफ्रॉस्ट शब्द का आविष्कार अलेक्जेंडर वॉन हम्बोल्ट ने ही किया था. सो परमाफ्रॉस्ट जो शब्द है फिजिकल ज्योग्राफी में, वो अलेक्जेंडर वॉन हम्बोल्ट की ही थी. इसके अलावा भूगोल की विषय वस्तु पर विचार करते हुए हम्बोल्ट ने एक शब्द विश्व रचना या कॉस्मोग्राफी का प्रयोग किया. और इसे ब्रह्मांड वर्णन अथवा यूरेनोग्राफी एवं जियोग्राफी या भूगोल में विभाजित किया था। हम्बोल्ट आगमनिक विधि के समर्थक थे और हम्बोल्ट का यह कहना था कि सभी प्रजातियों का उद्गम एक ही है, कोई भी प्रजाति श्रेष्ठ या हीन नहीं। हम्बोल्ट ने भौतिक भूगोल, जलवायु भूगोल एवं वनस्पति भूगोल के विकास में बहुत महत्वपूर्ण योगदान दिया है। यही वजह है कि हम्बोल्ट को आधुनिक भूगोल का संस्थापक माना जाता है। हम्बोल्ट ने ही सर्वप्रथम भूगोल की सात पक्षीय संकल्पना का प्रतिपादन किया था, जिसमें भूगोल में पृथ्वी तल का मानवीय अधिवास के रूप में अध्ययन किया जाता है, भूगोल संसार के क्षेत्रों या स्थानिक वितरण का विज्ञान है या स्पेशल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन का विज्ञान है। सामान्य भूगोल का नाम ही भौतिक भूगोल है एवं इसके अंतर्गत मानव का भी अध्ययन सम्मिलित है। भूगोल में संबंधों का अध्ययन किया जाता है या इंटर रिलेशनशिप्स जो है उनका अध्ययन किया जाता है। हम्बोल्ट प्रकृति की एकता या यूनिटी ऑफ नेचर में विश्वास करते थे। हम्बोल्ट ने भौगोलिक अध्ययन के लिए निम्नलिखित विधि तंत्र अपनाया। उनका प्रथम विधि तंत्र एम्पिरिकल मेथड या अनुभाविक विधि कहती है, दूसरा क्रमबद्ध प्रणाली या सिस्टमेटिक मेथड कहा जाता है, तीसरा तुलनात्मक विधि या कंपैरेटिव मेथड कह सकते हैं और चौथा कार्टोग्राफिक विधि या कार्टोग्राफिक मेथड कह सकते हैं। ये हम्बोल्ट जो थे भूगोल साहित्य में सर्वप्रथम क्लाइमेटोलॉजी शब्द का प्रयोग हम्बोल्ट ने ही किया था। हम्बोल्ट ने पृथ्वी को जैविक एवं अविभाज्य इकाई होल माना था। उनका कहना था कि देयर इज वन स्प्रिट एनिमेटिंग द होल ऑफ नेचर फ्रॉम पोल टू पोल। हम्बोल्ट को उनके योगदानों के कारण ही वनस्पति भूगोल, मौसम विज्ञान तथा आधुनिक भूगोल का पिता कहा जाता है। और हम्बोल्ट का पार्थिव एकता के बारे में कथन था कि देयर इज वन स्पिरिट एनिमेटिंग द होल ऑफ नेचर फ्रॉम पोल टू पोल बट वन लाइफ इन्फ्यूज्ड इनटू स्टोन्स, प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स एंड इवन इनटू मैन। तो दोस्तों, ये हिंदी और इंग्लिश दोनों में हम्बोल्ट के जो कंट्रीब्यूशन है ज्योग्राफी के लिए उसके बारे में ये डिस्कशन हुआ है। आशा है कि आप लोग इससे लाभान्वित होंगे।